a keynote speaker. Please join me in welcoming Reverend Azuki to the stage. But these days, it's relatively easy to travel almost anywhere in the world. And even if you do not actually go anywhere, the world comes to you via media, such as television and internet. You can even see anything on your smartphone or tablet. So I'll leave it on this one, a little bit of advertising for the home country. It's funny, in the United States, when they show the space arm, somehow they manage not to show the Canada word mark. But that is Canadian technology, eh? It should be much easier for us now to comprehend that all sentient beings on this planet are part of the same world we live in. We can view the Earth from space or dive to the depths of the oceans. We can see wildlife beyond our imagination and examine minute organisms that cannot even be seen with an ordinary microscope. Every day, we witness the triumphs and tragedies of people we'll never meet, whose languages we cannot speak, and whose customs, food, and traditions may be foreign to us, for we can see them at the click of a button. But this weekend, right here in this convention hall, we're sitting with people who speak other languages, have different traditions, and eat different foods. As human beings, we have much in common, the same kinds of worries and joys, and we also have our Nanbutsu teaching. We are gathered together this weekend thanks to this. You might have had other reasons for coming on this trip. Perhaps you enjoy getting together with people from other temples, or maybe you like traveling, or someone you came with likes traveling. You may have felt that it was your duty to attend, even though you have much to do back home. You may think you know what brings you here. It's our nature to want to be in control, to think that we know what we're doing and why we're doing it. But if we look back on our lives, we can see that many things have not gone according to our wishes and plans, and that we do not always know what will bring us happiness as a lasting sense of peace and harmony. Fortunately, we don't exist in this world independently. On the contrary, our lives are shaped by countless other beings and events going back to the infinite past. Every word that is spoken, every action that is taken, affects all life into the infinite future. Interdependence, not independence, is one of the marks of the Buddha Dharma. Thanks to the truth of interdependence, we are who we are in this moment. We are indeed embraced by the oneness of life. Due to our karma, our causes and conditions brought about by this truth of interdependence, we find ourselves here today. Isn't it incredible that almost 2,000 people have come from many far-flung places to be in this room together at the same time? And how did you get here? Many of you came by plane. Did you find this unbelievable? Perhaps not, since most of us have come to take air travel for granted these days. There's a popular American comedian named Louis C.K. who points out that when we arrive at our destination, we usually just talk about our flight by saying things like, the food was terrible, or there was no food, the seats were too cramped, the movies were boring, or there were no movies at all, it was too hot, it was too cold, and so on. Nobody ever says, wow, I just flew in the air, sitting in a chair for thousands of miles in a few hours. Isn't that amazing? We take our lives for granted, we still complain. And yet, thanks to countless beings and causes and conditions, here we are. Thanks to the immeasurable wisdom and compassion of life, here we are. Though we're all from different places, something has called each of us to come to this convention. In our limited way, we may not recognize this call and cannot fathom the depth of it. It is incredible. It's inconceivable. We're caught in the vast and eternal flow of life beyond anything that could be imagined. We who are gathered together this weekend have much to be grateful for. And yet, when this trip is over and we return to our homes, we may also return to a feeling of disquiet as we face uncertainty, worry, and even fear about the many things that are happening in our lives and in the world today. Everywhere, people are concerned about economic stability, access to health care, violence, including things like bullying, war, terrorism, climate change, in other words, issues of well-being and survival, even for those who are relatively well-off and comfortable in their lives. How will the future generations fare? In some way, these issues affect everyone. We live in an age of uncertainty, which is difficult for we who have become used to thinking that we are in control. Did we really believe that nature's resources would supply us with limitless energy to fuel our endless desires? Did we really believe we could cut down forests or fill the air and waters with pollutants without causing dire consequences for the whole planet? Are we always prepared for natural disasters? Thinking we're altruistic and compassionate beings, do we really believe that we can help 7 billion people on this planet to enjoy the same standard of living as we do? Are we willing to give something up in order to fulfill a wish of peace, tranquility, and equality in the world for all beings? Knowing we're imperfect beings, beings who complain about flying, who long for home-cooked food rather than fancy hotel meals, who view others as better or worse or different, imperfect, foolish beings as we are, Can we even think to make a positive difference in the world? What are we to do? We are one world. We can't sit idly by while the world burns. We're not the first human beings to live with uncertainty and fear. Through the ages, mankind has always faced new challenges and the unknown. Perhaps our problem is that we've come to believe that we can rely on our own power to survive. With all our knowledge, we've gone very far away from the truth. I'm a Sansei, a third-generation Japanese-Canadian. A century ago, my four grandparents immigrated from Japan. My father's parents were from Oita-ken, Bungo-Takata, near Usa. My mother's parents were from Hiroshima-ken, Asakita-ku, Shiraki-cho. Hundred years ago, people did not fly in an airplane from Japan. The voyage by ship was long and uncomfortable. There was plenty of time to ponder the foreign country they were going to. Did they worry about the language? Were they afraid of meeting people who looked so different from them? Did they know how they were going to make a living or how long they would stay? Would they ever go back to Japan? Would they ever see their families again? So much was unknown. This was only the beginning of their difficulties. Imagine how hard it must have been to start a life with next to nothing in a strange land. There was discrimination. There was hardship. There was sacrifice. Gathered here today, there are many of us whose parents, grandparents, or great-grandparents face the same trepidation and uncertainty as they embarked on their voyages to unknown lives in Brazil and other places in South America, Hawaii, the United States, and Canada. What gave them the strength and courage to keep going forward? They didn't have money. They didn't have status. Where did they find such strength? Many of the immigrants came from areas of Japan that were strongly Jodo Shinshu, and they knew they could rely on the Nembutsu. No matter how dark or rocky the road was, they could move forward, confident that they were embraced by the vow, by the innermost wish of infinite life that enabled them to live their lives as fully as they could in the circumstances they found themselves in. Like all first-generation immigrants, my grandparents worked hard to make a living for themselves and for their families. And then World War II began. As in the United States, the Canadian government decided to move people of Japanese ancestry away from the coast and put them in internment camps. You may have admired the beautiful Rocky Mountains from here, at least in the pictures that were up here. Just on the other side of the Rockies was the internment camp that my grandparents and some of their Canadian-born children were sent to. It's a place called Slocan. They were shipped there by train and were only allowed to carry one suitcase of belongings each. Everyone was uprooted from work, from school, from their daily lives. Families were separated and given next to no time to prepare. Homes, businesses, fishing boats, and other possessions were confiscated or abandoned when they were ordered to leave. People could take so little with them, but my grandmother made sure to carry a small myoko, the six-character nembutsu, Namamidamutsu, with her, fortunately in a way. Some kaikyoshi were also interned, and in time, a temple was built in the camp. I don't doubt that the Nembutsu teaching gave a lot of people comfort and strength in the face of such great injustice and prejudice. When the war ended, Japanese Canadians could not return to the coast for a number of years, so most of them kept heading east for thousands of kilometers, ending up in Toronto. Once again, they had to build lives from scratch and rely on the kindness of others to help them establish homes and find jobs. Toronto was even then a very cosmopolitan city where you could meet or hear people from all over the world as you ride the subway or walk the streets. So this turned out to be a great place for another new start. Their world was expanding thanks to causes and conditions that worked in an inconceivable way. Though moving to Toronto was not in my grandparents' original plan, this is where life carried them. Eventually, Reverend Kenyu Tsuji, a Nisei minister who was later to become the Bishop of the Buddhist Churches of America, established a temple downtown. It was there that my grandmother often went for services and Fujinkai gatherings. And because she spent a lot of time looking after me, it was called Obachanko, I often went with her, though I didn't understand a word that was spoken, as everything was in Japanese. I just loved being with my grandmother. You might think that this is why I eventually ended up becoming a minister, but it's not as simple as that. If you ever bemoan the fact that your children or your grandchildren are not interested in the temple or the teaching or are not even Buddhist, you can stop fretting. Remember, things don't always go according to our plans. In the river of life, there's a calling voice, a power that's much stronger but more subtle than ours alone, and we each hear it in our own way, in our own time. The working of that which we call Amida Buddha is beyond our limited comprehension. But if we look back at our lives and the many beings and events connected with us, we can get a glimpse of how inexplicable it is. Most of us here today share a common ancestry in Japan, but even if your heritage is not Japanese, or even if your family never left Japan, you too share a history that stretches back to the infinite past. Wherever you're from, reflect upon the centuries and eons of struggle and difficulties that past generations had to face in order for any of us to be here. All that we are, all that we have, is thanks not to our own limited efforts, but to our dependence on other beings and events from the past and the present. In this way, we're embraced by the oneness of life, and we're empowered. Everyone faces challenges in life. We each have a path, and though there may be times when we feel we're walking it alone, if we look at the course of our lives, we may be astounded at the number of different beings that have been involved in it. What does it all mean? How does it all come together? What is the meaning of our lives? In the Gandavyuha Sutra, the last chapter of the Avatamsaka Flower Garland Sutra, there's a young pilgrim named Sudana who sets out to find the answer to that question. He meets all kinds of enlightening beings, men, women, and children. They come from all walks of life. Some are religious people, but there are others who are, for example, beggars, prostitutes, housewives, or laborers. Each of them imparts some wisdom or observation and sends Sudana on his journey. He even meets Queen Maya, the mother of Shakyamuni Buddha, and all the Buddhas. Like chapter 5 of the Tanisho, in which Shinran-sama reminds us that all sentient beings without exception have been our parents and brothers and sisters in the course of countless lives in many states of existence, Sudana sees that due to interdependence, unlimited by space and time, all beings are like one's parents, and deep gratitude arises in him. At the end of his journey, after encountering many beings and having many adventures, Sudana is brought to realize that his own nature and that of all existences are one, are infinitely interdependent. How are we to understand this? Often it's beyond our imagination, but in fact, our lives are filled with incredible examples. When I was first assigned to a temple near Los Angeles several years ago, I didn't know many people, and I was thousands of miles away from my home and my family. Fortunately, as a minister, we have many opportunities to meet new people. One day, I met an elderly gentleman who had attended Waseda University in Tokyo about 70 years earlier. Amazingly, it turned out that he and my father had been classmates together there. Both were Nisei, but one was from America and one was from Canada, and both had been sent by their parents to study in Japan in the 1930s after graduating from high school. What are the chances of that? Our interconnections really do transcend space and time. And the story goes on. My father had passed away a few years prior to my meeting this man. His name was Mr. Nakagiri. So I had some of Dad's keepsakes with me in Los Angeles to remember him by. I found my dad's student album from Waseda days and soon discovered a photo of a very much younger teenage Mr. Nakagiri. He and my father had been good friends. Sometime later, I invited Mr. Nakagiri to come to the temple to look at the album. As soon as he opened it and saw a picture of my dad, his face lit up and he said, "There's Chiro." I was so moved to hear this from a virtual stranger. As he flipped through the pages, though, tears appeared along with his smile. He told me that this was the first time in 70 years that he was seeing these photos of his friends and teachers. Like my father, he had returned home at the outset of the war. He went back to the United States and my dad came back to Canada. They never saw each other again. He explained that in the United States, some of the Japanese were afraid of being found with anything that would link them too directly to activity in Japan. Because of this, Mr. Nakagiri's father immediately burned his school uniform, his books, and his photo albums. Realizing that these photos meant so much to him, I quickly made copies of some and gave him the originals. I felt such joy and gratitude to unexpectedly meet someone who knew my dear father so long ago. The stories he told were just like hearing my father again. And it gave me such a feeling of wonder to be brought to give him some happiness in looking at his friends again from a time before the troubles of the war began. We are infinitely interdependent. Sometimes we may wonder where our lives are leading us. We may try to take control of our course, but are we really so skillful? In our society, it is common and routine to act out of self-interest in a world that's become more focused on individual gratification than ever before. Even when we think we're doing things to help others, we're actually the ones who need help. Okage-sama-de, thanks to others, we're enabled to flourish. We cannot rely on our deluded selves. Like Sudana, each of us is being drawn along a path that might seem to lack coherent meaning because it is difficult to see how all beings are interwoven into the fabric of our lives. Moreover, we're too focused on ourselves to notice the role that other beings play. But thanks to our numerous encounters through the course of our existence, we can move forward and enjoy a life of meaning and growth. We are empowered by the compassion of others. These days, we're hearing more and more about empowerment movements in a mundane sense. There's female empowerment, minority empowerment, empowerment of the economically disadvantaged and the politically disenfranchised, and so on. Even in a mundane sense, though, empowerment is explained as a continuous process that involves relationships between beings. It can't happen in a vacuum because of the fact that all beings are interdependent. Power is received thanks to others in a constant flow of interrelationships. Think of how powerful we become in concert with others, compared to doing things on our own. In addition, the truth of impermanence, of constant change, applies to power too. Our relationships with others are constantly changing, and we depend on others to be able to progress along our paths. Empowerment doesn't mean that one person has power and nobody else does. Thanks to our interrelationship with others, we're always changing and growing and being enabled to give back to the interconnected web of life of which we are a part. So let's go back to the end of the war. People had arrived from the camps with nothing, but they had their families and friends, and from their life experience, they had a great spirit of entrusting and something that kept them positive and upbeat when others might have felt bitter and hopeless. They may not have known it then, but they were empowered. Due to their causes and conditions, my mother and my father each ended up in Toronto where they met. Thanks to that, my brother and I were born into a wider world. Our working class neighborhood was like a United Nations of races, languages, and cultures. This is now, but it hasn't changed too much in all those years. When our friends came to our house for dinner, they learned to say, itadakimasu, and when we went to their homes, we did whatever they did. Growing up this way, we took it for granted that everyone was different, and therefore, everyone was the same. This is Toronto today. We were raised to look at each person as a human being, regardless of the color of their skin, social standing, or other differences. Would this have been possible for us in Japan, or even in pre-war Canada? My parents in turn worked hard and made sacrifices to put everything toward our education. Remembering that what happened during the war, my father reminded us that material possessions could be taken away or lost, but that nobody could take away what was in our hearts and our minds. That's why it's so important for us to study hard, but also to discover our personal religious paths. We needed to have a good spiritual guide so we could navigate life as smoothly as possible, come what may. Everyone needs a reliable value system. This is as true today as it's always been. Though I went to a Christian Sunday school when I was young, I was unable to commit to it. Our parents had taught us to question everything, to test everything to see whether it was really true or just something everyone else believed. Like our teachers, they encouraged us to think for ourselves and not to be conformists. Between that and being so close to my devoutly Shin Buddhist grandmother, the seeds of curiosity were planted, but they seemed to lay dormant until many years later, when the events of my life caused me to really wonder what life is all about. Perhaps this has happened to you too. Thanks to my parents' dedication and devotion to us, and the encouragement and support of everyone around us, we were enabled to enjoy academic and career fulfillment. The prejudice that had caused my family to be in Toronto was quickly evaporating as the country moved toward a conscious focus on equality. We had nothing to fear. Anything was possible, even for an ethnic minority, even for a woman, even though we were neither rich nor famous. How far we had come since my grandparents first disembarked in Vancouver as immigrants. We were empowered by the great flow of life, just as they had been in their way. My career in the Government of Canada, My career in the Government of Canada gave me the opportunity to observe a lot of things about people, communities, and countries, and what motivates them. My work largely involved promoting and protecting Canadian companies with respect to international trade. Just as with smaller entities, it's natural that an us versus them mentality will arise. Of course, everyone wants to prosper, but there's always some party that wins and some party that loses. Within the bureaucracy, too, there's a lot of jockeying around for personal power. It isn't just politicians who act out of self-interest. Of course, this is very true in the private sector as well. Even with all the best intentions in any occupation, we're still just human beings, which means we all have imperfections. Over time, a nagging doubt began to arise in me about the direction I was headed in. Admittedly, I enjoyed the challenges of my work and the people and the places that came into my life while I was trying, I thought, to help others. But under the surface of such a heady world, something else was speaking to me. My posting at the Canadian Consulate General in New York City, the epicenter of finance, commerce, and yes, sometimes greed, was followed by 2 years in Ecuador, an emerald gem of a country where I socialized with the very wealthy, but participated in projects for the very poor. Did the official nature of the work make me any less of a hypocrite? Of course, at the time, I thought we were being so charitable. Ecuador is also home to the Galapagos Islands, where nature is carefully protected from the thoughtless acts of human beings. It amazed me that due to strict rules for people, the birds and animals did try to flee when we walked among them with the naturalist. And I started to think about our place in the world. How can we hope to help others when we don't know our own hearts very well? Do we really believe that our values are the best for all beings? Would the whole world be a happier place if we all had more money, more power, and more things? Canada was involved in some minor projects to aid undeveloped areas of Ecuador. This usually involved assisting the locals to install water pipelines or start marketing projects. But on one trip that took us deep into the jungle, it was to provide treadle sewing machines to a tribe that had been quite isolated until then. They found that making clothing for rainy season helped their survival rate. Over time, contact was made with many such tribes, especially as it was discovered that oil could be found in abundance in the jungle. At first, this seemed like a welcome benefit for the local natives, but later, uneducated and unable to defend their rights, they came to suffer terrible health hazards from ground contamination and other miseries brought on by contact with our world. We don't always know what's best for everyone. We don't even know what's best for ourselves. At the height of my career, I was an economic policy analyst in the Privy Council office, the highest office in the land, advising the Prime Minister and his cabinet. Sitting in cabinet meetings and listening to our national leaders deciding on economic policy for our country, my ideals as a public servant were sorely tested. I'm sure many of these politicians have started with good intentions of looking after the best interests of the Canadian people, but over time, power changes people if it's the kind of power they get at the expense of others. Something told me it was time to move on. But rather than regret these years, I'm grateful that they ultimately caused me to question my values. I also have to mention that, like many people, my work was so busy that I rarely had time for family or friends. And yet, they've been so patient, caring, and happy for me all the same. It's so humbling to reflect on this. Something was calling me to move forward. I wasn't afraid to let go of what was familiar. In a way, it would have been worse to stay with it and suffer the feeling of being permanently out of kilter. I just felt that there had to be more to life than power and advantage. Long story short, I felt drawn to live and work in Japan, where my reflection grew ever deeper. It was actually through a Canadian friend that I was introduced to the Dharma there. Fast forward through an amazing series of causes and conditions, and I found myself attending morning services and lectures at Kanazawa Betsumi, where I'd moved after living in Ibaraki-ken and Chiba-ken. Little by little, I realized that I'd found a teaching that explained my life to me. It almost seemed miraculous that I was offered a job and a place to stay at the Honganji International Center in Kyoto, where the staff and so many people at Hwansan helped me learn more about the teaching. I feel equally grateful to my classmates and teachers at Chuo Kyokakuin Seminary, who were so patient and kind, even though I'm sure I caused a lot of trouble with my inadequacies. If any of you are here today, I thank you from the bottom of my heart. I owe a debt of gratitude to you for help in lighting the way on this extraordinary path. But though this teaching has crystallized my guiding values and given me such peace of heart, everything that has ever informed my life is also a part of me. Even as ministers, we're also part of this greater world. Perhaps it goes without saying, but we cannot separate our spiritual life from our everyday lives. Thus, I cannot help but fall back into thoughts of economic issues in considering the difficulties in the world today. Clearly, we must change the way we view our purpose in life. There's no doubt that mankind must be brought to understand the wisdom of oneness before things get worse. We cannot continue competing with each other and destroying nature for our selfish desires. A skillful paradigm would focus on life and interrelationships rather than on material goods and the individual self. But first, we must each engage in our own self-reflection before pointing fingers at others. It's most important for us to sincerely and deeply understand that we are simply foolish beings who would be lost already were it not for the unconditional wisdom and compassion that we've always received from the oneness of life. I think we can all agree that there are many problems in the world today. When you think about it, they're all related. At the bottom of it all seems to be the economic model that our so-called advanced world has been following. It's a model that says that in order to be happy, people must acquire more and more things. It assumes that a person who consumes more is better off than a person who consumes less. The corporations that provide goods are well aware of something about human nature that has existed as long as people have existed. In the larger Skavadivyuha Sutra, Shakyamuni Buddha tells us that in ancient India, people were just like us. They craved wealth and got so wrapped up in pursuing pleasure and self-gratification that when their end came, they found nothing to rely on. It seems that human beings never learn. And to make matters worse, advertisers are very clever, playing on our base human emotions that cherish the self. In the process, human relations suffer. In English, we call it a dog-eat-dog world, in which survival or success depends on thinking only of oneself, even at the expense of others, including, ultimately, our loved ones. These days, even people in remote areas of the planet have access to knowledge about how others live. Everyone wants to have what others have, so the market for goods gets larger and larger. This is good if you're a corporation selling the goods, or if you own stock in these corporations, as many of us do, even in something like a retirement fund. Of course, we want greater profits, so it means that companies need to pay less for the cost of labor. However, since we live in so-called developed countries, there are lots of laws and regulations to look after the well-being of our workers. It's too expensive to pay workers under these caring conditions, so the work is sent to countries where the cost of labor and standards are much lower. It's ironic that two of the original Buddhist countries, India and China, are now pumping out manufactured goods for the world at such a rate that both are experiencing alarming levels of air pollution. Hello? There we go. We often hear of the smog in Beijing, but Delhi is the most polluted city on Earth. Life expectancy has dropped by several years in both countries due to the poor air quality. Even back in the 3rd century BC, the great champion of Buddhism, King Ashoka, had edicts to protect natural surroundings in India. As we know, pollution does not just stay where it arises. However, instead of blaming and judging other countries, we have to look inward. Before we start protesting that they should have stricter pollution standards and treat their workers better, we have to ask ourselves how many things in our lives depend on workers in India, China, and other countries. Are we willing to pay more for goods in order to protect other people and the environment? We cannot close ourselves off in an island mentality, for we live in one world. To paraphrase something Martin Luther King once pointed out, this morning you woke up between sheets made of Egyptian cotton and got dressed in clothing that was manufactured in China or Bangladesh. For breakfast you had coffee from Colombia, orange juice from Florida or maybe Brazil, bread made with the great Canadian wheat, and fruit from Hawaii or Guatemala. You walked here in shoes made in Italy, or maybe you took a taxi or drove here in a car made in Korea or Detroit. You probably checked your phone or your computer tablet for messages. Have you ever wondered where it was manufactured and what the working conditions are like for the workers who produced it? This isn't a lecture about the moral dimension of our consumption. It's about being mindful of our interconnection with all life. We just need to stop and reflect sometimes about where everything comes from and where it's going when we're done with it. We're very quick to say that the world's in a bad way, but we're much slower to look at ourselves and notice that we're part of the problem. Do we ever pause to think about the food we eat or the water we drink? Studies in many industrialized countries show that children have no idea where much of their food comes from. And why is it that we become so dependent on plastic PET bottles? Do you know where these bottles come from and where they're going to? If you fill one of these bottles a quarter full with oil, that's how much oil it takes to produce just this bottle. And it takes the equivalent of 3 bottles of water just to produce 1 bottle of water. As you may know, plastic does not degrade very well at all, but it causes a lot of environmental damage and that harms and kills countless sentient beings. Of course, there are programs to recycle these bottles. Do you recycle? Of course, there are programs to recycle these bottles, but we're not really trying all that hard to cooperate. First, we love our own comfort. When I was working in the international department at Onsen, I was told that our uniforms for the female employees were made from recycled PET bottles. And even though I was in my ideal world of living in the home of Jodo Shinshu, and the teaching was right in front of me all the time, I remember thoughtlessly complaining about having to wear that uniform during the hot, humid Kyoto summers. Even there, I was unable to be mindful and grateful, even for one day, and yet I was so fortunate to have that position there. Is it our habit, our practice to reflect on what we've received from other life? Or do we only think of our own convenience in our use and disposed lifestyle? We're very good at consuming. Will this enable us to die with peace of heart, I wonder? Our lessons are to be found everywhere. Back in my university days, I was fortunate to spend several months living at the 800-hectare hunting estate of a wealthy family in France. Again, thanks to a mind-boggling confluence of people, events, and timing. Many years later, I returned to visit, and I was shocked to find the estate in ruins. Only the family matriarch was still alive. I found her sad and alone in a nursing home, her legs amputated due to diabetes. And I'll never forget what she told me that day. Patricia, she said, no matter how great or rich we are, in the end, we are all very small. It seems that many of the world's woes arise from economic issues. Not only do we have economic disparities from country to country, but more and more within countries as well. Due to our insatiable desire for things, people are exploited and environmental impacts are devastating. As a result, we have climate change that brings natural disasters, as well as food and water shortages. Those of us from California, and I think Sao Paulo, are all well aware of the water crises, which in some way are going to touch all of us. In such an atmosphere, it's no wonder that there are still wars, and more recently, terrorism. Many conflicts today are not so much about nationality, self-defense, or religion, but about ignorance and economic inequity. Would things be different if everyone had enough? And how much is enough? I think that's something each of us has to answer. If it involves working so hard that we have no time for family and friends, that we become ill or our safety is endangered, or we risk death, is that a better lifestyle? And what about the lives of others on which our lifestyle depends? There must be a middle path. If we could remember right view, that all life is one, that there's no separation between self and others, then perhaps we would be satisfied with and grateful for enough rather than craving too much. We would know when to stop and when we were causing needless harm to ourselves and to others. However, it's very difficult for us to have the wisdom of right view, isn't it? And so we receive the great compassion just as we are, selfish and unmindful though we may be. In being brought to awaken to the fact that we are interconnected and interdependent, and that our very existence has come about thanks to others, how can we squander the lives we have? My life is not mine alone to squander. Our lives are precious. But how can we even begin to repay our debt of gratitude, realizing how tiny and inadequate we as individuals are in the vast cosmos of life? We can take a cue from those who have gone before us. Just live our lives fully and authentically, just as we are, without calculation to do good, but simply finding strength and joy in knowing that we're embraced and empowered by the oneness of life. We don't know how we may affect others, for as our past Monshu Koshin Otani wrote, we are moving in the flow of something greater than ourselves. Life is always uncertain. There's no way we can know what lies ahead, but the working of infinite wisdom and compassion gives us the assuredness to advance forward. Thus, we have the example of Shin Nansama and so many generations and eras of people after him who were empowered by the Nembutsu to venture into uncharted territory. Through new interrelationships and experiences, we thus benefit from a life of meaning and growth, not only for others, for ourselves, but for others too. Around the time that the Issei were immigrating to distant lands, the founder of the Fujinkai and daughter of the 21st Monshu, Lady Takeko Kujo, was transcending her own difficulties She's known from working with the disadvantaged in Tokyo and in the aftermath of the Great Kanto earthquake, as well as being instrumental in the founding of the Great Ashoka Hospital. In Muyuge, her collection of essays, she wrote, "The anxiety of our age comes from not reflecting on our limited strength, and because of this, forcing the expenditure of energy. When we become aware of a strength greater than ours, we can manifest greater strength in our individual efforts. Only when we understand the limits of our strength are we able to truly love our insignificant existence that is constantly being shone upon by the limitless light." In a modern context, we have the inspiration of a Jodo-shin Buddhist from Hawaii named Alison Onizuka, the first Asian and Buddhist astronaut to venture into space. So mindful was he of his guiding path in life that he wore a medallion of the Honganji's wisteria, the Sagari Fuji, on a space mission. Tragically, in 1986, the space shuttle Challenger that he was riding in exploded. But he left us with this thought: your vision is not limited by what your mind can imagine. Make your life count, and the world will be a better place because you tried. We don't have to be astronauts or heroes to make our lives count. When you're a minister, be the best minister you can be. When you're a homemaker, be the best homemaker you can be. When you're a singer, be the best singer you can be. We're not perfect, but the important thing is to honor the lives we've been brought to live and allow our best to shine out of gratitude and joy. We may never know how we influence others. Who knows how many were inspired by Alison Onizuka because he lived his life to the utmost. Recently, a fourth-generation Japanese-Canadian woman was shortlisted for the Mars mission, a one-way voyage that aims to establish a human settlement on Mars. The innermost wish of life gets passed from many to one, and one to many. These say were no less undaunted in going forward into a new world. They were made to be who they were, thanks to their predecessors. I often think about my grandmother and how she did everything with all her heart for the sake of her family. She was always so happy for me, even as I thought only of myself. When you're a grandmother, be the best grandmother you can be. You may never know how it counts. One day during my hectic life in New York City, I felt an urge to go home to Toronto to see her. Due to a flight delay, I arrived late, only to learn that she had just died unexpectedly of heart failure. That day she had inexplicably told my aunt that she was waiting for me, even though she didn't know I was coming home. I just wish I could have said thank you. Imagine if she could have seen me here and dream this path. But in my heart, when I say onembutsu, she's always beside me saying it too. I still have my grandmother's little miyoko today, the one she took to the internment camp and then to Toronto. Before it became too fragile to carry, I used to take it when I went on hospital visits to see San Fernando's Sangha members. It's always given such comfort to the patients and to the dying and to me. People like my grandmother just kept going no matter what. Namamida Butsu sustained her, and therefore her family, and ultimately, me. She didn't try to force her teaching on anyone. She just lived in it herself and transmitted that joy and peace of heart to others. We didn't even speak the same language, but I learned so much about living my life from her, and this she never knew. Like her predecessors, the most important thing for us to do is to secure our own entrusting heart to the Dharma and then guide others to the same path, Jishin Kyomichi. Through deeds more than by words. We can only do this by experiencing the truth of the teaching in our lives and being made aware of our karmic imperfections, as well as the infinite wisdom and compassion that surrounds us at all times. Then we may be brought to see that our lives are infused with meaning because of the oneness we share with all beings. Being thus empowered, we'll be brought to advance forward, not only for our own benefit, but for that of others too. Though it may not happen in our lifetimes, perhaps this understanding will spread from each of us to our families, to our communities, to our countries, and eventually to the whole world. Then we will be one world sangha. During my time working at Honsan in Kyoto, staff recited the Jodo Shinshu Creed every day at morning service. It sums up what I've been trying to say, and so I hope we will continue on our journey with these words in our hearts. And if you know this, please join me, Gassho. And trusting the vow of the Buddha and reciting the sacred name, I shall proceed through the journey of life with strength and joy, revering the light of the Buddha. Reflecting upon my imperfect self, I shall strive to live a life of gratitude. Following the teachings of the Buddha, discerning the right path, I shall spread the true Dharma. Rejoicing in the compassion of the Buddha, respecting and aiding one another, I shall do my best to work towards the welfare of society. Namanda, namanda. Para meus amigos brasileiros, muito obrigada.
Good morning. Before I do our pre-meal meditation, I would just like to say on behalf of the Calgary Buddhist Temple, thank you for coming to Calgary. We hope you have enjoyed your visit, and we hope you will please come back and see us again. Please, Gassho. We are gratefully indebted to the many lives and everyone's kindness as we receive our food. Namo Mirputsu.
Namo.
Namo Mirputsu.
Namo Mirputsu.
Namo Mirputsu.
Namo Mirputsu.
Iridakimasu.
guide us.
Thank you, Sensei. Again, to facilitate safe and orderly departure from the room, please remain seated until directed by an usher. Allow the first row of dignitaries to leave first, followed by the District of Japan, BCA, South America, Hawaii, and then Canada.